Cayman Compass sports journalist Seaford Russell here at the Compass building for the Seaf Show, joined by a very special guest, the Minister of Sports, Mr. Bernie Bush. You know, we are coming off of the Carifta Games, arguably one of the biggest Carifta Games in the country's history, with track and field and swimming. You were there with the swimmers. But before I get into the good stuff, right, there has been some controversial stuff. Of course, everyone in the public might have seen by now the situation involving Lacey Barnes and the Cayman Islands Athletic Association. It's been stemming on now for the past 3 days, and we haven't heard from the sports minister on this situation. You being a former president of the Athletic Association, sir, what are your thoughts on this situation that is transpiring right now?
But it's twofold. First, since we go into athletics, let me start off and saying one of the things that I regret, because there's some things about this that I'm happy it happened, but I'm regretting that people are not seeing that Anthony Chin Jr. won a bronze, Andrew Stone won a gold, and Devontae Howell won a gold.
Yeah.
And really and truly, I've yet to hear why Andrew Stone did not go into the high jump, because at 14 or 15, he jumped 2 meters. So he's jumping above 2 meters, and the winning jump at Carifta in the high jump, which he won silver medal in last year. He would have got a gold medal in as well. So it is disappointing, and I have not heard why he was not entered in that. But getting back to the situation at hand, like I said, I'm sorry that all of this has overshadowed the three athletes and what they've done. Miss Barnes' situation was regrettable in some ways, but it was maybe sometimes you have to do radical things sometimes to get things to the attention of the people. But I'm going to say this. This stuff has been going on for a while. The way they handled Miss Barnes, where she was embarrassed, should have been that way. But also, on the other hand, the people in the Bahamas maybe should not have accredited her without the association giving an okay. So it could go two ways. But why I say this has gone on for a long time, Miss Barnes in her clip said that there was no physiotherapist. And one of the reasons I have said nothing before now is because you want to do your homework before you jump up and say, I support this one or I support that. You want to know what's what. Now, I know plenty of the sins of the association. Like you said, having been the president who rebuilt it from scratch. And when I look at what happened, she said there was no physiotherapist.
Right.
I think it's like 18 months or 2 years since her father and was the president of the Athletic Association. Good friend of mine, he and I have a good relationship. I spoke to the coaches. They don't remember any physiotherapist being on the trips or a masseuse. They don't remember any of their athletes being given shoes. So all this has gone on before. What I really wish Ms. Barnes had addressed was the selection process of not only the coaches, which is what caused this. Now, you and I have just had the pleasure of being with the swim team, watching what went on there. And as you saw, you had three different coaches there, all accredited. Yeah. And even our athlete from overseas, they accredited that coach. They didn't necessarily, they may not have paid for them to come or whatever, but you got accreditation where the coach can work with the athlete, because the athlete has a bond with their coach. And the same stupidness, and I'm going to call it that, has been going on with the Cycling Association. Just a few weeks ago, we had a young man leaving, and a week before the young man, Nathaniel
Forbes,
he was told, we're not making your coach go with you. And he refused to go. Any athlete in his position would have done the same thing. Now I hear that sometimes it comes down like it's these associations get personal. But I'll get back to the cycling with that later. What I think I was hoping Ms. Barnes had addressed is who they sent as the coach had none of his athletes qualify. None. And some of the other athletes do not like the person that they sent as the head coach. So this is a fact, because I've spoken to athletes, I've spoken to parents, and I try not to speak to the coaches too much.
Mm.
So that is what, those are the things that I wish Ms. Barnes had addressed in this.
I just want to jump in real quick just to clarify who you're referring to.
I'm not calling any names at this stage, please, if you don't mind.
Okay.
But they selected a head coach. None of his athletes qualified. No. Coach Stanley, who jumped, I think he teaches throws, four of his athletes qualified.
Mm-hmm.
Then you had four people from Miss Bent qualified.
Yeah.
And the other 12 were from Mustang Coach Tyrone. Coach Tyrone is a level four. If I was sitting there in that seat, that would have been my automatic selection. Why bring someone who's retired? Why bring someone who has no one making the team? And so that is where I see part of the problem starting from. But this is not the first time that this has gone on. Another thing that if I was in Ms. Barnes' shoes that I would have made a fuss about was the selection of the athletes.
Mm.
When I was president, or when we had our association there, at the under 17 level, if you want to use the word developmental, if they say the qualifying time was 14 seconds, and a person ran 14-1, and they were 14 or 15, I would take them.
Yeah.
Because you want them to get seasoned, to see what it's like, see what level. You've seen swimming do that, yeah, with the four little musketeers.
Yeah, yeah.
And it ended up that they got got medals. But this is where I think the things that need to be discussed. What sensibility and logic, and I feel it's egos and personalities. And at the end of the day, who's suffering at the time is our children. And why I say, there was one athlete taken that was the one athlete that came from the head coach club.
Mm. Mm.
That athlete was injured before they left Grand Cayman, got to Karifta, was injured, never competed, and came back injured. But yet, I can name two young ladies who qualified maybe at a high school meet. But that's another discussion in itself. Why weren't these high school meets not being sanctioned? Because the same people, officials, who they use were at the meet.
Mm.
Mr. Francis, who's one of the greatest at his job, was there controlling all the timing and everything. The starters are all people who are recognized by the association. The only two people I didn't see there are three people, the three members of the executive. But all officials who are usually there were there. You had a young girl who is 13 years old, is going to be 14 in September, October. She won both the 100 and the 200. She beat everybody in the under 17 category. Why wasn't she taken? Delora Johnson jumped high jump, qualified at the high school meet. Why wasn't Delora taken? Why take a young man that's injured? So these are the questions that has to be asked. And that's what I wish Ms. Barnes had jumped on. But she was right. When she said she made a call to someone about shoes for the athletes, you know who she called? It was me. I paid for the shoes, and Kenneth Bryan helped, Isaac Rankin, and Ventisha Connolly. We were who put together the money and helped the athletes. She called us, called me. So these are the things that where I would say, you're saying when an athlete is going to a competition,
yep,
it's like you're going to war. You need a proper artillery to take part. So if an athlete is going to war, and the parents are not able to afford to buy these things, it's the association's duty. As you know, the athletes told you when I was president, they never had these type of problems.
Mm.
I made sure they did. It was always about the athletes, never about the coaches, never about the executive. It's become too much, in my opinion, the egos and people. And if you offend me as a coach, I'm not doing nothing with you. If I don't like you, I'm not. Not because it's better for the children, it's because I personally don't like you. And I'm sorry to see the association in this thing, but maybe it needed to be brought up. But this is nothing new. So that's where I will part ways with Ms. Barnes. I'm glad she brought all this out. It happened in the wrong way. But sometimes these things need to happen.
I want to ask you about how this situation was handled from both parties, and because I feel like it could have been something that was dealt with behind the scenes, but obviously Lacey came out and spoke out against how she had been treated. And about 2 months ago, another athlete who competed on the Athletic Association, Alex Pascal, he also recently came out and spoke out against the association as well. And you know, you say that this is something that has not happened, continues to happen from generations before. But what needs to be done? What needs to be done in order to prevent this from continuing?
Well, a lot of people, from what I understand in social media, is saying, where's the minister? What is he gonna do about this? People must understand the rules. If I, as much as put one finger inside that association, the international body will suspend Grand Cayman, or the Cayman Islands, and our athletes cannot compete. That's the first thing people must understand. Where I can affect it is that I will, when they ask for a grant, I will give them no grant until they get the house in shape, which is a big problem in the associations around Cayman, quite a few of them. But I just, as you know, just formed the sports commission. One of the things is those who think they're focused sports, think that they're going to remain focused sports, no. You're going to have to earn that. And so that's one of the things that we're looking into.
Yep.
But this thing could have been handled better, yes. Like I said, it goes back to the selection of coaches. And if you have an athlete on the team who is being coached by an individual and they want accreditation, it's not costing the association nothing.
Yep.
It does not cost them anything, because where the athletes, where the coaches will stand, they're not on the track. They can sit in the stands where the athletes can see them and they can signal them, they can get them on the practice thing before they go on into the protected area and so forth. So there are ways of getting there. But as we saw in swimming, they accredited and the coaches that were there. And this is something, it all comes down to ego. I remember people saying to me, why are you accrediting Mr. Jerry Harper?
Mm.
By that time, Mr. Harper was a royal peen. But it was always about the athlete and the sport. And once you understood that, you put up with his questions, you put up with his prodding you. And whenever he had an athlete and he wanted to go to the games, I got him the accreditation.
Right.
Why? Because his athletes wanted him. It must always be at all times about the athlete. And a lot of associations miss that. You have some people who have been in these associations since Jesus had on short pants. And they do not want to step out to give new blood the chance. They think that these associations is their birthright.
Mm.
And you wonder why some sports have gone nowhere. And I've stepped on some toes. And because people who know me know I say it as it is.
Mm.
And don't tell me that I don't know. I was the founding member for Special Olympics. Myself and Jimmy Powell rebuilt cricket from scratch. I rebuilt track. When I took over track and field, it was eight, and I still have the books, $88,000 in debt. And I took it out of that, left a surplus there. Never had none of these controversies. At all times it must be about the athlete.
Yep.
And until people start to remember that, why you go there. Now you have some parents, which is another problem, because the people in Cayman who want to volunteer that much time is limited.
Mm.
So you have a lot of parents who volunteer or come out and help. But then when their child moves on, they move on. But then you have some people that hang behind, and those are the ones that when you see their child, the children are big, and they're still there volunteering. And then there are also some people who are in this for the wrong reason. They want to travel. They want the free trips. They want this and that. And no one ever wants to pass on knowledge for some reason. I looked this year, and this is when I do have my meeting, the wrap-up meeting with CIASA. I'm going to compliment them. They had two young assistant managers to the manager for the trip.
Yes, yes.
Which I think is very admirable. They're trying to get the older person to pass on the knowledge to the younger person. Now, how much the older people who are in these spots are willing to pass on, I don't know.
Hmm.
I didn't go and talk to, are you being shown to go to a technical meeting? Are you shown Because the first time I was dumped in, I had a man by the name of Elsmer Gray, Tate Gray. He babysat me for my first 3 days in Mexico. 5 o'clock every morning, make me see what you have. And he would show me, because he'd been to so many of these games, he knew it inside out. So when you have someone willing to pass on knowledge, and I would quote Dr. Jackman, and that he always said to me, when I pass on knowledge to you, I don't lose it. Mm. I still have it as well. Until people start to think that way and be happy to pass on knowledge to young people, because not everybody is an athlete. And at a young stage, some people realize, I am never going to be fast. I'm never going to throw far. But I still like being around the scene. I can help by helping with the paperwork. Yeah. I can help by timing. I can help by being a starch and this and that. But these people get these positions and they never want to let go. But even now in track and field, some of the things that are going on just around the track and field community. I had two parents, I had one parent say something to ask me what I thought about Miss Bent. And I said, what about Miss Bent? I know she's a nice lady and she seems to have become a very good coach. And sure enough, one of her athletes just won
bronze.
Said, because I had someone come to me and tell me, say, I must take my child from Miss Bent because she's not good and give them to someone else. Those things are very bad habits. Mm. And I am hoping that when these things happen, people will address these people face to face immediately. Because that's the only how you can stop these things. But people tend to sue behind each other's back and stuff like that. But those type of unethical, underhanded things is not the right way to go. A perfect example, just to show you what working together is. Andrew Stone, the same young man, last Carifter, I attended with athletics. Mm. This Carifter, I went with swimming. Tyrone Yen coached Andrew in the high jump. Carlos, welcome, coached him in the long jump. The young man is so talented. No,
Carlos Morgan.
Morgan, yeah. Carlos Morgan. If I say the wrong name, I'm sorry. It was Carlos Morgan. Yeah. He coached him in the long jump. Now, Carlos just had a baby. So, and anyone knows him, though, he's a Christian.
Carl.
And one of the twins, Carl Carlos. And I still don't know the difference between them. But they're my boys, good boys.
Yes.
And what he did, he now asked Lacey's husband, who's also from, to help with Andrew. When he's jumping, the long jump. So that's what it should be about. Tyrone had no problem getting Carlos to work with Andrew in the long jump. Tyrone knew his strength, Carlos knew his strength. So that's what it should be, but you shouldn't be going telling parents or telling kids, your coach don't know what they're doing or they're not good at it, come to me.
But why are they not allowing the coaches to help their athletes? Why this isn't the first, like you said, this isn't the first time that the Athletic Association has had this problem, and there's multiple athletes that have voiced that they would prefer to have their coach train them at these international and regional meets. But why are they preventing these coaches? Is it a financial thing?
Well, it depends. A lot of times. There's a quota given. Sometimes the association will be told you're allowed so many coaches. Now we have a technical director who I say is very good. He and I have discussed it, and the same plan that I had in place, he has in place, and that is, let us get a high jump coach, let us get a long jump coach, let us get sprint coach, let us get a middle distance, so you have coaches for specific events.
Yeah.
So, but I'm so sorry he has to work with who he has to work with. I will say that right here now, because there's some egos in there and people that think, we say a lot of times, athletes, when they step up and they retire, they think because they were an athlete, it makes them automatically a good coach. Or it makes them automatically a good administrator. It does not. I learned that from the greatest of all, Pelé. Mm. I asked him, why did you become a coach? He said, because what God blessed me with, other people didn't get that. and what I'm expecting from them, I was doing naturally. So it doesn't happen that way. So being a good player or a good track athlete or a good anything does not make you a good coach or a good thing. So, and that's something we also have to accept. And it could be a financial thing. I know one thing that the association, I've heard the people complain about, which I haven't looked into this, so I can't confirm this, that they're still using the same uniform that they used for the last 2 or 3 years. The fact that some of these athletes didn't have shoes and they're going to represent the country, which, like I said, this is not just this administration, the administration before. So, Mr., I understand someone said to me that the president said that this is the best administration in the last decade. I will say this much, and I will say this without any, I will not back off of this one. The benchmark that he had to pass wasn't very hard, because the ones before, in the last decade, none of these associations impressed me at all, and they had athletes to work with. They never had, like, when we took over the association, we had bad press. I walked into Cayman Airways, they said they didn't want to see me. I walked into CUC, they said no, they don't want to see me. I walked into Sleep In, I owed them $60,000+. I mean, just one place. And so I had all this I had to contend with to try to rebuild it. 4 or 5 national athletes at the time. And so I am happy that Miss Barnes did what she did. Maybe it was at the wrong time, I don't know, but I'm happy that a lot of this has come out, that we can now discuss it. And so when we can discuss these things, we have improved, hopefully. But I can tell you this much, there's a few times when the Athletic Association had their child molestation case, if I had been sitting on that executive at that time, I would have resigned, and I would have told my board, let us all resign, because we have failed in one of the main jobs, and that is protecting our athletes, and especially protecting our girl athletes. So this is maybe another case. If I was sitting there, and you find so much people, and especially the athletes, are not pleased, I would say, okay, drop my hands and says, put a new board in place.
You know, it's funny you mention that, because recently Delroy Murray, the president of the association, actually issued a personal statement, you know, saying that this is not him speaking as the president, but this is Delroy Murray speaking. And he issued this letter, and pretty much said, listen, I hear a lot of people calling for my resignation, but it's not going to happen. And sort of retracted his apology to Lacey Barnes. I don't know if you're aware of that, but...
Someone also said that that in that statement, they said that when I said this, I don't keep, because Mr. Murray and I have had a relationship where he was my vice president. I do know this much. Some of the things that when we were on the outside that we complained about, he's gotten there as president, and it is still going on, which has surprised me. Technically, he is very good. In fact, when I stepped down as president, because I've always had this belief, you do a term or two, and then you step down and hand it on to the next person, and everybody's supposed to keep elevating the associations. I know he's also of that belief. He's not a person that wants to stay there for 10, 12, 14 years. He's not into that. I also know that he's an honest man. Now, what has happened, why all the, some of these things are still going on, that's in there. I'm not on the inside. I can only go by what athletes tell me, what parents tell me, and what coaches tell me. And I can tell you this much, this is nothing new. The same old has continued for the last 12, 14 years. What makes me sit back and wonder, and it just hit me just now. Certain members that have been there, they got rid of DW as president. Then they got rid of LB as president. Now they got Delroy. but a certain set remain there. And so maybe it's time, like I said, for the whole board to just give someone else a chance to do a better job. Because doing a better job, I can tell you, won't be very hard.
I hate to stay digging in the mud of controversy, because we have so much good stuff to talk about as
but
well.
But if you do not discuss these things or bring it to the public, it will never be addressed.
100%. And it begs the question, right? Because as you said, this isn't anything new. Certainly not just to one association. This is across the board. Obviously, we have seen track and field have their hiccups over the years. You brought up the sexual assault, the sexual matter with that individual there, and you know, we had a sanction recently when it came to the Krifta game, some financial issues, and now Lacey.
Which I'm going to back the association. The association was not wrong. The international body moved the goalposts. So let's get that straight. That those sanctions were wrong. This is what I tell people. A lot of people jump up and jump to these things and don't know the facts. I took the documents to the Attorney General as I got in, because they were still asking me for the money. And one of the chairpersons of the committee is behaving real asinine. But the money was there. Who made this money? It was the Athletic Association. Give them the money. From what I understand, they took in care of the treasury and gave the treasury, which is just someone being spiteful. I'm working on that right now. But real and truly, the people who suspended us were wrong. The documents showed that. So it was that, like I said, I'm not here to take sides. So you here I am now defending the association on that one.
Yes. One of the other things that I wanted to bring up in light of this, all this controversy that's happening, on the football side of things, I've spoken to several of the men's national football players, and they have expressed to me their dissatisfaction with the current board of CIFA. They have, you know, made complaints to me saying that, you know, they don't understand the coaches sometimes, and obviously the results that our men's national team has been producing as of late is far from good, if I will say that. I want to get your thoughts as a former football player and a former football coach. What are your thoughts on the current state of our men's national team? Because the women's have been doing exceptionally well in some cases, but the men have really suffered as of late.
I'm going to be very honest. Having been the individual, and I will always give props to a gentleman by the name of Mr. Ronnie Roach, when I went to start the Pee-wee football for girls in the primary schools, that was me. I built the girls program thanks to Bruce Blake. No help from any other executive members at that time. Bruce Blake was the only one who gave me any assistance and any help. Built it from scratch. Like I can always brag, no other program has ever gone that high in the rankings like that under 17 program. Now I'm going to say something that is, once again, they continue to bring these athletes, or these coaches from overseas, to coach what? People that don't have certain fundamentals. One of our best coaches in this country happens to sit on the executive of CIFA. I cannot question why he isn't coaching, why he hasn't personally said, give me the national team. But it doesn't start there. We have to start in the primary schools.
Yeah.
Put it this way, I am right now in talks with one of the top four clubs in the English Premier League. In fact, one of the top three. And I'm hoping to sometime in the next month or so to announce where I'm going to get six coaches, all for under 12 level qualified by that club. Then after that, we look about getting them the children that these people that I am going to handpick. And then send them to their camps, and from those camps they can be then invited to join their academies. I have a plan in place, and until we build a foundation, if you remember what was done with the Martinez young man, where he was sent off to England and stayed with a family over there, that is where we have to go. If we sell, we are telling young people at the age of 16, 17, 18 that you're going to go pro, that is next to nil. That's going to happen. When they hit 15, 14, 15, 16, that they're not associated with any club, with a good academy or whatever, what our next step should be is getting these young people ready for university in the United States, making them use the football as a avenue to better education. So I can honestly tell you, I do not have any comment to make on the men's program. It has hurt me over the years. But another thing that I've identified, because no one ever looks into the what's causing a lot of these problems. Very few of these clubs, now you have 3, 4, 5, you have academy, you have a few of those that have, that are trying to develop the young players. But everybody wants to win. Okay, here comes John Brown coming from Timbuktu, arrives in Grand Cayman, and right away he's on a work permit, and 2 weeks later he's playing football. He's on the field, first 11. We've got a 15 or 16 or 17 year old that's half decent, but you can only improve if you're on the field. You can only improve if you get game time. So from a long time ago, I said to the association, could you, this was even before the present administration, I asked them, can you put a quota of who can play on the field at one time? Each team can only have 2 or 3 foreigners or something like that, or maybe 2 or 3 people on work permit. I don't know how to put it. And that way, it will force the clubs to get the junior program good, find junior players, bring them through to the senior team. Because when Cayman was really rolling, do you know Scholars Football Club?
Of course.
Okay. You had to be a West Bear. Strikers, you had to be in town. Bordentown, you had to be very few people. And the junior teams that came up fed into those teams. So that's when our football was at the best. And you know why? Every one of us was playing. We knew Sunset would have people who came in on there. That was a different case. We knew CNB would do it as well. But McAlpine, you had Woods, you had all these teams were just Caymanians. Now these days, I remember going to a match one night, and I watched Sunset play Scholars. And there was one Caymanian on the field, and he was playing for Sunset.
Wow.
And I did not go back to football for a long time after that. And you know, you hear me, I still bleed yellow and blue. Scholars, I had so much good times, we won so much, I had some awesome times. Then I turned around and I founded Future with Mr. Floyd, Mr. Arnold, with John Kelly and Dion. But until we get back, that where we're getting our young people on the field playing, football will continue to suffer. Until we get coaches at the lower level who are very good, that are teaching fundamentals, teaching. Did you think you'd ever see the day that these little private schools could beat a public school? That's happening now, and beating them easy. Why? These people have gone, they pay some decent coaches. It's not that the guys, some of the local guys that are helping with the primary school can't coach either, but those people are pumping money into it. The level of coaching that they've brought in to coach some of these boys, the younger kids, that's why they're doing better. We have to do that across the whole island. We have to do that across where we get coaches to work with the PE teachers, where when you see, and that's my ministry's job, talent identification and development. Now I'm about to get all of my staff to start to go into the school on a daily basis to look at these, and when we identify these young athletes who are exceptional, is to get them there, is to try and say, okay, what's the next step for this athlete? Talk to the parents. That's me and you, the mother and father, help sell this child a dream. A lot of times, if it's left to the child, sometimes when they'll kick out the school and they'll get home and it's PlayStation. But we have to say, I know something, the coaches have identified you, that you're quick, or you're talented, or you can jump high. So guess what? We're going to go training, and you tell the child, you do this, you get to go on a little trip. You find what makes the child click.
Right.
It has to be about the athlete. But like I said, the associations have forgotten this. Nathaniel Forbes, right now, just went to Jamaica, made a very good name.
Yep.
I've just seen the selection for the, I think it's the Pan American or something, and they didn't pick Nathaniel. How can you pick one of your, not pick one of your top two cyclists in the country? It must be personal. I contacted someone close and said, yes, he would go, but he's not going. But to the final thing is this, I cannot interfere. Don't come and ask me for any funds. Because when I see these type of things going on, you're not going to get a 5 cent from me.
Yeah.
Before, it has to be, I have to see your books to make sure that if a government gives you any money, I want to see that the money is not going on foolishness.
Mm-hmm.
I have to give God thanks for my staff. We set up a list of things that you have to do before you get money from us. It goes through a panel before it even gets to me. So they vet it before it even gets to me. But it's too many associations that I save the emails. And a lot of people are now BCCing me on stuff. And you see the correspondence that goes back between some individuals and these associations, and you're saying, how can they operate this way?
Mm.
I remember at one time, the last AGM I went to with athletics, two people went with me, two gentlemen. One was from a trust fund, and one was from a dental group.
Mm.
Each one of them had promised me they could do in a vicinity of $50,000. We got in there, and the questions were asked, and nothing, and the members got fed up, and we said we call for a vote of no confidence. Mr. Barnes said, no, I'm not accepting it. Later on, I'm going to give him credit where credit is due, and the two gentlemen got up and walked out and said, this is a joke. The members calling for no vote confidence, and they're saying that they're not accepting it. And you got all the numbers in the room to vote, no confidence. The two men left, never put any money back in. They put it into one of the football clubs.
Mm-hmm.
I know that as a matter of fact. So these are the things where we keep shooting ourselves in the foot.
Sir, I'm going to leave it on that note.
I want to close with saying that sitting here today with a young sports journalist as yourself, Mr. Russell, and to watch Andrel Harris produce this show, it makes me feel proud as a Caymanian to see two young Caymanians in this field. And as much as I try to avoid the press, I'm happy that when you asked me to please come and do this, I told you I would because of you. And now to see Andrel over there producing the show and watch you all set up all this, I want to say thank you all as well for trying to get the full picture.
Yeah.
And because we have to stop jumping to conclusions, we have to get our facts before we start to either shoot people or prosecute people. Sports is an awesome vehicle to better health, to education, social integration, which is one of the things I'm looking for, which I'm seeing in rugby, believe it or not. And this is where we have to go. This is why we have to back this. And I want to say that there. I'm hoping and praying that my government will keep on backing me in some of these endeavors that I tried.